Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a dialogue piece to constructively analyze, to constructively critique, to constructively engage our viewing audience in discussion on issues that we tend not to want to deal with. Welcome and Happy New Year 2005. I'm Brian Wade, and I'd just like to welcome you to our program this evening. I'm going to introduce my guest shortly, but I wanted to just make you aware that we had a successful 2004 college tour, and we're looking to visit South Africa in 2005. Additionally, we're planning to go to Johns Hopkins University, Morgan State University, and to complete our tour at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. Again, I'd like to thank all of our corporate sponsors for making this possible. At this time now, I'd like to introduce my very special guest from Washington, D.C. First, I'd like to introduce in the studio Dr. Janice View. Welcome to Worlds Apart, Dr.
Thank
View.
Thank you, Mr. Wade.
Yes, give us some background about yourself and what you do.
Currently a middle school teacher at Capital City Public Charter School in Washington, D.C. I'm also the education and training director of Just Transition Alliance, which is a national organization that brings together labor unions and environmental justice activists.
Yes. Give us some background about your education.
Well, Washington, D.C. is my hometown. Mm-hmm. I'm a proud product of the D.C. public schools. Mm-hmm. Went to Syracuse University for undergraduate school, Princeton for master's program, and Union Institute for a doctorate in education.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you for appearing and coming
you.
From Washington, D.C. Additionally, I have on the phone from Washington, mm-hmm. D.C., Mr. Lawrence Guyot. Welcome to Worlds Apart, Mr. Guyot.
Welcome and congratulations on having an excellent program.
Thank you so much. Give us some background about yourself, sir, and what you do.
I'm from Mississippi. I was involved with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. I was chairman of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. I led the congressional challenge of the Mississippi delegation in 1965. And otherwise, I work now promoting one of the best books ever written.
I have to agree with you. That's why I'm so excited to promote this book. I was in Washington, D.C., meeting with the Poverty Race Research Action Council, Mr. Hartman, and we were talking about their work. My cousin had introduced me to, I guess, their work maybe 5 or 6 years ago. And you meet so many people in this line of business, you know, to some extent. And I was just looking through a lot of my books. I'm a pack rat, you know, teachers and pack rats. And I found one in their articles, so I called them, and I wanted to network with them. And as a result of talking to Mr. Hartman, I came aware of this particular book that I'm really excited to introduce. And it's a resource guide. And the title of the book is called Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. And I have one of the editors here, Dr. Janice View. It's also co-edited by Deborah Menkhart and Elena Murray.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
And the organization specifically that put this together was Teaching for Change?
Well, two organizations. Okay. Teaching for Change is one of the publishers, and Poverty and Race Research Action Council is the other publisher. So
okay.
The two together combined forces to publish the book.
Well, I'm very excited to promote this book. When I saw this, and they sent it to me because Chester Hartman had told me about the book, and I started looking through it, and I'm a teacher by profession, and I saw that. I said, boy, this is great. I mean, great. I mean, it's very panoramic. I think in some ways it's holistic in terms of the panoramic scope in which you're looking and examining the civil rights movement. But what I wanted to do is talk to my guests on the phone first because I don't know how long we'll have him. But Mr. Guyot, give us your perspective about the book, if you would, please.
I spoke to 200 teachers in Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
Capitol Museum, 60% of them were white. And when I finished speaking about the book and about the work of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, they not only ordered the book, but there's going to be some of them were from Neshoba County. Neshoba County, the Neshoba County teachers have met and voted unanimously to adopt the book as the curriculum for the schools in Neshoba County, Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about the Neshoba County.
Right.
Where Shawna Cheney and Goodman were killed.
Exactly, because when I heard about Mississippi's involvement in this, you know, I think generally there's a stereotype here in the East, you know, Mississippi, the last state to basically abolish slavery within their constitution. And here they're one of the states that's in the forefront promoting this book, correct?
The superintendent of Macomb, Mississippi,
mm-hmm.
where more churches were bombed than anywhere else in the state, in the South, has ordered 50 copies of it, is going to be conducting a conference on it. A couple of weeks ago, I met with some veterans from the SNCC movement in Jackson, Mississippi,
mm-hmm.
and I sold some of them the book, and some of them that already were buying their second copy. John O'Neill with the Southern Theater bought his copy. Dave Dennis, Hollis Watkins, who had Southern Echo. So I talked to Leslie McLemore, who teaches at Jackson State, about the book, and he said, "Oh, I already have five copies."
Right.
So it's really, and I think the reason I spoke today before the city council about the right of residents to vote, and I put the book on the screen and said, "This is the best Christmas present you can give anyone."
I agree.
And people there in the audience began to buy the book. So I would encourage people, take it seriously. It is a tremendous organizing tool, and you can't buy a better Christmas gift.
Okay. Well, Mr. Gill, I'd like to thank you for being my phone guest from Washington, and we're looking to coordinate again, and you'll be an in-house guest on my radio series to further give your perspectives on this particular book.
I look forward to keep up the good work.
Take care. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lawrence. you would think we pay him.
Right,
and
right.
We don't.
You don't pay him.
No.
Well, Dr. View, I wanted to talk and ask you first, what was the catalyst behind putting a book like this together? You know, why a book like this?
It was interesting. Teaching for Change put together a conference, I guess it was about 4 years ago at this point. Different teachers, especially K-12 teachers, said, you know, we'd love to have some different materials and resources on teaching the civil rights movement. Surely there must be something we can learn from our peers. And Teaching for Change decided to put together a conference. It was a day-long conference at Howard University. And they brought in veterans from the civil rights movement, teachers who have done interesting lesson plans over the years, different resources. And at the end of the conference, countless people said, "You need to do a book. You need to do a book." And at first we thought, oh, you know, we don't have the resources for that. How would we do that, et cetera?
Right.
And eventually we decided, yeah, I think we should do a book.
Okay. So, I guess in talking to you when I came to Washington to sort of prepare for the program, depending on who's orchestrating what they want to know about history, you sort of get maybe a narrow perspective about the contributions with respect to the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm. Does your book look to address that, to provide a broader, sort of more in-depth analysis of the contribution within the civil rights movement?
Absolutely. I think people tend to think of the civil rights movement very narrowly. It started in 1954 with the Brown v. Board of Education decision. It ended in 1968 with either Dr. King's assassination or in 1970 with the advent of the Black Power movement and the Black Panthers and so forth. We knew better than that. We knew that it was more than just African Americans, that in some ways the civil rights movement started in 1492 with the first European encounter with the indigenous people on the soil, that it continues well into 2004 with hip-hop activism, that even during the time frame of 1954 to 1968, there were countless people of all races, all genders, all ages that were involved in social justice and political and economic justice.
What we need to do now is take a break. If you're just now joining me, I have in the studio Dr. Janice View, and we're looking at the book, Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Support for Worlds Apart is provided in part by York Foundation, a community foundation, and Susquehanna False Craft Company.
Last year, Emily, Gabrielle, and their mom, Brenda, were in a serious car accident. The children were having problems getting their life back to normal after the accident. However, their lives changed when they participated in the United Way-funded Girl Scout program.
People do need to donate to the United Way. They need to know that the money is not wasted, that it is going to good programs, sound programs that are helping people.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
Welcome to a new world in emergency care, Fast ER. Fast ER was developed to treat the less severe emergencies more quickly. You know, simple lacerations, minor burns, sprains, fevers, bee stings, sore throats, flu symptoms, and minor headaches, the bumps, bruises, and scrapes in life. So come to Memorial, great physicians, great nurses, and Fast ER emergency care. Memorial Hospital, a premier medical center.
Glatfelter Insurance Group is pleased to be a sponsor of Worlds Apart. At Glatfelter Insurance Group, we believe in the value and dignity of every person and the power of education to promote a stronger and more diverse workforce.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have in this studio Dr. Janice View from Washington, D.C., and we're highlighting this wonderful book that I'm pushing. Maybe I'll have the same impact Oprah has when she pushes books like that. No. But I'd like to just make our viewing audience aware of this book called Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. And I was sort of directed by Janice's mother, who's in the studio, to make sure that I showed her on the screen. But I said, we got to take care of Mom, you know, but she's an associate producer while she's here anyway. But I'd like to thank you, Janice, for coming from Washington to talk about
my
the book.
My pleasure.
In the book, you talk about a lot of aspects. I know there's several compartments, lenses, perspectives in the book. Mm-hmm. If you would, take us through some of the basic segments of the book, if you
sure,
would, please.
Sure. There's one section where teachers who have used some of the materials from the book or who have reflected on their own teaching about the civil rights movement have articles. There are three primary sections of the book, citizenship, education, and economic rights, mm-hmm. where we've sort of grouped articles that are consistent with those particular themes. We look also at culture as an aspect not only of the movement itself, but how the civil rights movement impacted the larger popular culture, mainstream culture.
Right.
And then there's a section that looks at, you know, sort of looking forward. What lessons can we take from the movement that are important to us in 2004 and beyond? Mm-hmm. So those are some of the sections of the books. Right. There are also six lenses through which we looked at the movement. As we tried to gather lesson plans, as we tried to gather articles, photographs, poetry, etc., to expand the way people think about the civil rights movement and how they use the materials in their classrooms or in their community groups or so forth. we wanted to make sure that the issues relating to women, to young people, youth, that organizing was a lens through which people understood the movement. Again, culture. How culture was used and influenced to convey messages of social justice and so forth. The interconnectedness of the various social justice, economic justice, political justice movements, and institutionalized racism. Mm-hmm. Through those six lenses, we wanted to examine the material that was coming to us to make decisions about where to put them in the book or whether they should be in the book at all, what it taught us about the different people and players and strategies and outcomes mm-hmm. Of the different parts of what we think of as the modern civil rights movement. Mm-hmm.
So with that kind of analysis and critique, does that in and of itself provide maybe a basis for potential solutions as we try to understand and put in a proper context what impact the civil rights movement has on today? You know, I know a lot of people talk about, well, dealing with this issue of civil rights or racism, what are the ultimate solutions? Education mm-hmm. clearly is one, mm-hmm, would you say?
Mm-hmm. Well, we certainly hope so. That's partly why the title is Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. It wasn't a static moment in time where angry, tired black people just said, okay, we've had enough, and then when they were appeased, said, okay, well, now America's back to being the way it used to be, or back to being good, and now everything is healed or repaired. That social justice is always a constantly moving
force. An evolving
force.
Continuum, right.
The continuum is a force. Right. And that the people who were at the leadership, that we think of the public televised leadership, we think of Dr. King, we think of Rosa Parks, sometimes people remember Malcolm X and other sort of national figures. Many of the really important leadership of the civil rights movement were people whose names we never know, right. We never will know. And to understand that you don't have to have a Harvard Divinity School degree to be a leader in a given social justice movement, to understand that you can be below the age of 21 and do something significant and important that helps make the world a better place, that you can not have any kind of education, formal education at all, but that you have something to contribute is something that we wanted to impress upon people, to sort of highlight as part of what we think we already know about that period in history, but also help people today understand that there's leadership in all of us, there's power and activism in all of us, in the different ways that we can influence and impact our world.
I noticed you were very deliberate, and the editors were very deliberate in highlighting the contributions not only from those who got more of the media attention, but mm-hmm. I call them salt of the earth types of people.
Oh, absolutely.
And I thought it was, you know, a very comprehensive and an in-depth look. Let's talk about some of the contributors to the book. I know as I look and read the book, boy, some of these contributors span the spectrum in terms of academic background, but quite impressive, if you would.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, certainly we solicited a lot from teachers around the country. We were particularly concerned with getting materials for elementary school kids because a lot of the primary source materials and even some of the things like the Eyes on the Prize video series and other things are pitched more toward older students, mm-hmm. middle school and high school students.
Right.
So we were very interested in soliciting materials that spoke to the needs of elementary school teachers. So teachers contributed a lot. I mentioned the primary source documents. One of our contributors, for example, is Sonia Sanchez, who said, take any poem you want or anything I've written and you can use it for the book. And so people can take some of those primary source pieces and build lessons around them if they don't already, if there's not already a lesson attached to it. And it's not just for teachers, obviously. It's just a resource for classrooms and communities.
Some of the other contributors, Howard Zinn, I'm familiar
Howard
with
Zinn,
his work.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, most of our advisors were not simply figurehead people. They either reviewed text, they offered suggestions, they put us in contact with different people who were active in the movement or had materials that were going to be useful. Some folks that said, here's my photo archives. Take whatever
wow.
you want.
And you know? Full of photos. I'm telling you, this book right. is contextually tied in with the lesson plan, so it's full of photos. I'm telling you,
right.
It's not boring, you know, looking through it, but I think it's very well put together. Any other contributors you want to mention?
A lot of folks from the Rethinking Schools Network, Bill Bigelow, mm-hmm. Linda Christensen. I might have to take a little flip.
That's okay. It's your book.
Danny Glover mm-hmm. is one of our advisors. Juan Gonzalez from Democracy Now. Mm-hmm. So we have, you know, teachers, we have journalists, we have sort of, you know, sort of famous types, either they were active
right.
then or active
broad
now.
Broad ethnic participation.
Absolutely.
And your book reflects that too.
Absolutely.
So, and that's what I appreciate about
absolutely,
the book.
Yeah.
It reflects all the ethnic contributions.
Exactly.
And we'll sort of have a commentary about that in the program
okay.
too. But if you're just now tuning in, I have with me as my guest Dr. Janice View, who is one of the co-editors of the book Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. And she's my special guest coming from Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. and I was so glad that I could help promote this book because I think it's excellent. We're going to go into some more content about, you know, how it was specifically tailored for kindergarten, middle school. So what we'd like to do now is pause from words from our sponsors. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Brookside Motors, York County's largest pre-owned dealership featuring every make and model. Imports, domestics, cars, SUVs, trucks, and vans, all at the best prices. Here's what our satisfied customers have to say.
My experience here at Brookside Motors was a pleasant one.
Brookside here, I thought, had better quality and service than any other place around.
I feel very comfortable about referring other people to Brookside Motors.
We were recommended at Brookside, and once we looked at Brookside, we didn't even feel a need to look anywhere else.
Great cars, great prices, and great service. Hurry in today.
Underwriting for Worlds Apart is provided by Pinnacle Health. Pinnacle Health Systems is a charitable organization dedicated to maintaining and improving the health and quality of life for all people of Central Pennsylvania. Remarkable things happen at Pinnacle Health.
When you want words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized, when you need to have confidence as well as courage, when it's your health, your body, your life, we have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
Hi, I'm Freddie from Freddie's Furniture and Carpet, Harrisburg Mall. I'm located on the second level across from the food court. Please come visit us. We have financing available to all. The real deal.
Worlds Apart is underwritten by Graham Packaging Company. Graham Packaging Company values diversity in the workplace as a competitive advantage.
There's a better way to push your merchandise. You get more than you bargained for in our classifieds.
I'm over 50, and even though I didn't have any symptoms,
I got tested for colon cancer.
I didn't even know I had polyps.
They don't always cause symptoms.
But screening can find polyps.
So they can be removed.
Before they turn into cancer.
This is one cancer you can prevent.
I am so glad I got tested.
If you're over 50,
talk with your doctor.
And get tested. Screening for colon cancer saves lives. Medicare helps pay for colorectal cancer screening.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me in the studio Dr. Janice Few, who's one of the co-editors of the book, Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. And I have on the phone from Atlanta, Georgia, Ms. Connie Curry. Welcome to Worlds Apart, Ms. Curry.
Thank you.
Yes. Give us some background about yourself and what you do.
Okay. I became involved in the Civil Rights Movement, actually myself, in 1960 when I moved here to Atlanta. And I was at the founding meeting of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in Raleigh, North Carolina, in Easter weekend of 1960. And I got to know a lot of the students involved from all over the South. And although I was not that much older, I was out of college, and Ella Baker and I were asked to be on the executive committee of SNCC. And I was the first white woman on the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, Executive Committee. Mm-hmm. And I was with SNCC in that capacity for some years. Then I worked for the American Friends Service Committee, again in the South, doing mostly school desegregation, voter registration, or organizing around voter registration, and helping people who, after the Civil Rights Act, of 1964, enrolled their children into the white schools under the Freedom of Choice Plan, and suffered all the setbacks of that courageous choice. Then I came and worked for Maynard Jackson in Atlanta in city government, and about 14 years ago, I took early retirement from city government and began to write about some of the grassroots people that I had met during the movement. So since that time, I've completed four books in collaboration with people in some cases. My first one, Civil Rights, I wrote about a woman in Mississippi, Maybirth Carter, and her family in Sunflower County, Mississippi. And then a couple years ago, a friend and I made a documentary of that struggle for freedom based on the Carter family in Sunflower County, but we bring it right up to date, which in my terms is a resegregation in the public schools and a sort of a fast track to prison for youth of color. So that's my present work, is trying to educate people about this terrible dropout rate and everything else, and how many young black men are going to prison.
Okay, Ms. Curry, what I wanted to ask you, why are you promoting a book like this? Is a book like this important in terms of trying to get this information out into classrooms, churches, and communities?
Oh, my goodness, yes. I've spoken a lot everywhere, all over the country, because of my books and also because of the film. And I go to high schools, middle schools, and colleges. I haven't been to too many younger than that. But the lack of knowledge is just astounding when I either talk about the books or when I show the film. These young people do not know anything at all. It's like it was ancient Rome. And I said, you know, this was just within my lifetime and not very long ago that this was happening. Mm-hmm. Particularly the first segment of the film, which shows what segregation was like in Mississippi. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a friend of mine who teaches said that in Virginia, said that here's their students' interpretation of civil rights. Rosa Parks sat down, Martin Luther King stood up, and a whole bunch of white students came down in the 60s and saved everybody. And that's what they know. And they mostly don't have a clue about the local people that made the movement into reality.
Well, Ms. Curry, we don't have a lot of time, but I wanted to thank you at least for providing some support and endorsement for putting the movement back into civil rights teaching.
Well, I think it's an absolutely incredible book.
Okay.
Well, it's so needed.
Okay. Well, thank you for being my guest from Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
All right, then. Take care.
Bye. Mm-hmm.
Again, she's sort of endorsing the fact that I guess in a lot of ways, a lot of people haven't been able to really fill in a lot of the blanks regarding the whole contextual relationship about the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why a book like this is so mm-hmm. important. Mm-hmm. If you have any final thoughts, you know, we're going to do another program. But this book also is broken down into lesson plans. And I know we have 2 minutes. You want to maybe give maybe a kindergarten perspective about a lesson plan, if you would?
I think one of the easiest and simplest story that a kindergarten teacher might do related to the civil rights movement is to line some chairs up and have one person be the bus driver, one person be Rosa Parks, and one person be the arresting officer, and they'll reenact what they believe to be the story of the Montgomery bus boycott and how it got started. We have a lesson in this book that tweaks that a little bit and says even for kindergarten and first grade kids, you can still line the chairs up, you can still have kids play acting those roles, but understand differently what the relationships were among those people, that Rosa Parks didn't act alone, that she was part of a larger organization, and have kids play a fuller enactment of that whole scenario. So that's just sort of one example.
Well, again, I'd like to thank you for coming from Washington, D.C. We're going to prepare for part two. But if you're just not tuning in, I have with me as my guest Dr. Janice View, who's one of the co-editors of the book, Putting the Movement Back into Civil Rights Teaching. And it's co-edited by Deborah Menkart and Elena Murray. And they're co-editors. And the forward is by Congressman John Lewis.
Yes.
I think he's congressman in Georgia, correct?
Oh, absolutely.
Very good.
Yes.
Well, again, I'd like to thank you for coming from Washington. We're going to prepare for part two and to go into more analysis about the book.
Okay.
Again, for our viewing audience, Worlds Apart is favored to promote books similar to this, and we're looking to do the same thing on our radio series, Reconciliation, to highlight this book. And I wish you a lot of success, and I hope the book does very well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for appearing on the program. For Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
Ooh, there's nothing quite as ugly as to